Hi, my name is Terry Cavanaugh, and I want to thank you for joining us here at Old Town United Methodist Church for our virtual worship service. As you know, I am not your pastor, but I do want to thank your pastor for inviting me to share this time of worship with you. Let us get started with a call to worship. Grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. The psalmist wrote, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Let us pray. Give us grace, O Lord, to answer readily the call of our Savior Jesus Christ and to proclaim to all people the good news of his salvation, that we and the whole world may perceive the glory of his marvelous works, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. Now let us join our hearts together in the pastoral prayer. Spirit of God, breathe into our hearts peace that is content with your love. Spirit of God, unite us in honoring the gift we are to each other. Spirit of God, give nations and our nation common cause to strive for justice and the welfare of all people. Spirit of God, fill us with your grace to trust in your promises and to accept your forgiveness for ourselves and for others. Spirit of God, breathe into the whole of your creation the peace that comes from you alone, through Jesus Christ. Amen. Now I invite you to join me, if you will, in the prayer Christ taught to his disciples, the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. The message this morning is, He did it all for you. We're going to be looking at John chapter 20, verses 30 and 31. If you have your Bibles, turn with me. Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. As we look at these two verses, we realize that Jesus is coming to the end of his ministry, the end of his 3.5-year sojourn here on this earth. He is coming to the close of his ministry, and as one writer puts it, these words are the concluding episode in Christ's ministry here among us. So what is he trying to communicate? Over the next few moments, we are going to talk about three activities, three that Christ did just for you that are found right here in this text. First, he came into our world just for you. Think about that for a moment. He left all the glory of heaven to come into our world just for you. Even before Jesus was born, God wanted to make sure that everybody understood why he was coming. Listen to this. Remember when Joseph and Mary were to be married? And Joseph was unsure because here's Mary, she's pregnant, he's not sure what he should do. An angel comes to him in a dream and says these words, "She, Mary, will bear a son, and you are to call his name Jesus, for or because he will save his people from their sins." Christ came into this world to be a Savior. The angels proclaimed the very same message to the shepherds out on the hillside the night he was born. Remember, the angels came to the shepherds? Here's what it says in Luke chapter 2. And the angels said to them, "Fear not. For behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord." Notice it does not say, "Born unto you this day is a mighty king," or "a mighty military leader," or "a great politician." We have a tendency to put our faith there in these things, but born unto you this day in the city of David is a Savior who is Christ the Lord. You see, friends, Christ is the only person who was ever born in order to die. Now, we will all die. I'll give you that. I'll grant you that. But we didn't come into this world planning to die, hoping to die. Christ came into this world knowing he was going to die. And not only was he going to die, he was going to die for your sins and for mine. Jesus himself knew this, and he called himself a Savior. Look at Luke 19:10. For the Son of Man came to seek, to look for, to find, and to save the lost. We know Jesus came for us, to save us, to redeem us. And we don't have to go any further than that famous verse in John 3:16. We all know it. Let's just quote it together. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. So we discovered this morning that Jesus came to be our Savior. We learned this from the angel's conversation with Joseph. We learned this from the angel's presentation and proclamation to the shepherds. We learned this from Jesus' own lips. We learned this as children when we were still on our mother's knee. And she taught us John 3:16. Christ came into this world to be our Savior. He came just for you. But that's not all he did. Jesus not only came for you, he performed his miracles for you. I know you're saying that. Wait a minute. Hold on, preacher. I haven't had my sight returned. I haven't had leprosy healed. What do you mean he came to do miracles for me? Listen to this. John chapter 20. Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you, who? The reader of John. So that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. And that by believing, you might have eternal life. Or you may be asking, how did Jesus do miracles for me? John tells us. John tells us that Jesus did many signs and wonders. He did many things that are not written in this book. But the ones that were written down so that you and I might believe. So that we would read these stories and realize that Christ is who he said he was. The Messiah. The Christ. The one who was to come. As we read these stories from his first miracle, where he turned the water into wine, all the way through, they were all about believing. Look at John chapter 2, verse 11, where Jesus has turned the water into wine. Now listen to what John said. He said, this, the first of his signs, Jesus did in Cana of Galilee and forgive me, let me take a sip of coffee. And manifested his glory, and his disciples believed in him. Notice following the miracle, Jesus' disciples believed in him. Right up to the very last miracle. The miracle of his death, burial, and resurrection. You know, there is no greater miracle than the miracle of his death and resurrection. Yet, following that miracle, the centurion who had mocked Jesus, who had crucified Jesus, after Jesus' death said these words, "Truly, this was the Son of God." It's all about belief. He did it so people would believe. We see that Jesus was helping people to believe with his miracles. From turning water into wine, all the way up to his death on Calvary, it was about his miracles leading to belief. One writer said that in the book of Acts, every miracle is the bells calling people to worship. We've seen this morning that Jesus came into this world just for you. Jesus did his miracles just for you. However, God wasn't done yet. God created the Bible just for you. Look again at John chapter 20, verse 31. "But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name." Jesus tells us that the Bible was written so that we might believe. Without the Bible, we wouldn't know about Jesus. Without the Bible, we wouldn't know about salvation. Without the Bible, we wouldn't know about the Holy Spirit. Without the Bible, we wouldn't know about the empty grave. Without the Bible, we could never have come to faith. Paul tells us in Romans, "So faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ." Paul also tells us in 2 Timothy, "All scripture is breathed out by God and is profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness." Without the Bible, you and I would be like lost travelers, traveling without a compass, traveling without a map. But God loved us too much to leave us stranded in this life. He has given us his word. Through his word, we know Christ's sacrifice. We know that the only requirement we have is to believe. Are you willing to believe and trust in him? Jesus said, "Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever hears my words and believes them, he will have eternal life." You might say, "I don't trust others." But do you trust God? Look at what God's done for you. God sent his Son for you. God, through Christ, did miracles for you. God made sure it was all written down for you. And all he asks from you is that you believe. Will you believe? Amen. Our time has come to an end. I hope that you have enjoyed this worship experience. Please hear these words of benediction. Go forth in the assurance that Christ has done all he can to help you to believe. So my challenge to you today is simple. One word. Believe. Believe that he is the Son of God. Believe that he is the Messiah. Believe that he is our Savior. Believe. Now, may God fill us with all joy and peace in believing through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.